And now, it's time for another Dice Tower Review with Tom Vasel.
You know, I've been getting ready to talk about this game, Sea of Clouds, and suddenly I thought, what is this game even about? Because on the picture on the front here, it shows this ship flying around in the clouds, and there's islands that are going up and down, and I was like, what is that? Is that even in the game? Well, kind of, sort of. This is a pirate game where you're trying to get loot and rum, and, well, a lot of rum. This game has a neat mechanism that is used as a side mechanism in some games, but this game uses it as the main one, where do you want this now, or are you going to pass it up, but give more to the next person who goes there? It's a cool concept, and it makes for a fun card game. Here's how it plays. The goal of this game is to get the most victory points, and players are going to do that by getting coins, which are worth one victory point, and getting cards. Each player is given a pirate board, which is just where you're going to keep the different cards you get over the course of the game. They'll start with some money. One player is given the first person token. It's just to remember at the end of the game who had the first person token. And they also get the parrot. The parrot will win some tiebreakers. However, the parrot can be stolen by different cards and things. So there's going to be a round of the game, and in each round, each player is going to take a turn. And on your turn, you are going to start with the pile number one. There's three piles of cards here. Each of these has one card in it. And I'll look at this card. It's a letter of credit. Take a face-up card from an opponent. He gets coins equal, so I can steal a card from somebody else. Well, no one even has any cards yet, so that's not worth it. So I put that back, and since I didn't take it, I will add another card to it. Then I look at this one here. This is a boatswain. They have a value of 2 in combat. I'll take them. And so then I'll take this person and I'll put them in my pirate area. So you'll see the backs of the cards show kind of what's on that card. So then this card is replaced. The next player to go is going to take pile number 1. And so they're going to go that, well, they can steal this from someone else. And they get some rum here. Now this top shelf rum at the end of the game is worth 1 point. But if I have the most top shelf rum, each of them is worth 3 points. That seems pretty good. So I'm going to take this and put this in front of me. And then this one I have to play immediately, so I will steal that pirate. But then I get gold equal to I get 3 gold because you stole my pirate. And then this is replaced. And this keeps going on. Each time you look at a card and you don't want it, another card is put on top of it. And if you don't take any of the piles, then you simply get the top card of the deck. Sometimes the piles are negative. Some of the cards are negative, so you definitely don't want those. And there is a limit. If there's 3 cards in an area and you don't take that pile of cards, then a doubloon is added to that. So eventually someone's going to take it because there's going to be a lot of things there. So what are on all these cards? Well, on the different cards are different things. You've already seen some rum. Here's a fake rum, which is worth minus 1 point. There are different pirates. I'll talk about pirates in a moment. There are things that do, like this one here, makes you lose one of your cards, a peg leg. Well, I don't necessarily want that. Here's premium rum. That's worth 3 points. There's a lot of these artifacts here. Now, when you get an artifact, you'll notice that if I have 1 of this tooth here, it's minus 2. But if I have all 6 of them, that's worth 32 points at the end of the game. Now, most cards are played face-up. These are played face-up. Pirates are played face-up. Rum cards, and sometimes a card will show a secret symbol on it. These are placed face-down underneath your board, so you can keep your rum cards secret. Let's take a look at some of the other cards in the game. There's all different types. There's collector's rum, which is worth points, the more that you have. Here's a shell, which is just worth a single victory point at the end of the game. Here's another one of those relics. See, if I only have 1, it's minus 3. 2 minus 1, but if I get all 8 of them, it's 43 points. So there's all sorts of things in here. There are some things that at the end of the game, they'll give you points for however many of something else you have. Pirates. Now you'll notice here, this board here, after everyone has a turn, we move the ship once. When the ship leaves a spot with a pirate symbol on it, then everyone is going to compare the strength, this is the strength of this pirate, to the strength of all the other pirates. Or actually to the strength of the pirates, to the person to the left and right of you. Now, if your strength is higher than the person next to you on either side, you beat that person and you can do what it says here. So this lets me steal a rum card from that person. Hopefully it's a good rum card because not every card in the game is good. Not all the rums are good. This guy here, Vulture Pete, exchange 1 face-up artifact with another face-up artifact. O'Malley, exchange a rum with a rum that's taken randomly from an opponent. This guy here, I get three. This says one time. And that's because when you do these, if I beat an opponent on both sides of me, I'll steal a rum from both of them. This guy gives me three coins, but even if I beat both people on both sides of me, I will only get the three coins once. So you can see when you're taking pirates, you're going to be looking at their strength to see how well they'll help you in the battle, but you'll also look at their special ability to see if that's worth it if you win a battle. Whether you win or lose the pirate battles, at the end of a pirate battle, all pirates are discarded, and you start again. So there's going to be three battles over the course of the game. And after the final battle, the game ends, you take your coins, add it to the points on cards that you've gotten. Whoever has the most points is the winner. Now, Sea of Clouds works well with 2 to 4 players. And I've played it with the 3 different numbers, and I like it with all 3 of them. And I like the fact that when you go to each spot, and you're like, this is a good card, but the next one might be better. There's always that greed that grips your heart because you're like, oh, that next one might be better. But you're also sometimes looking for very specific cards. For example, you might be trying to collect that rum and you want to have the most of that collector's rum. And so you're sitting there going, okay, I need to find more of that. Or there's a card that's just not that good and you're like, I'll pass it by and go look for a better card. Oh, that's well and good. Sure. Pass something by and go find a better card. But every time you pass a card, another card's added to that pile, or possibly coins added to that pile. And I like that because then the next player comes through and goes, ooh, 2 cards. Nah, these are okay cards. But if I pass these by, I'm giving the next person 3 cards. That's neat. It's a good concept, and it works really well in this game. Also the different types of cards. Do you want rum, which is hidden points from your opponent? Some rum isn't good, but you might collect a lot of the rum, even the worthless rum, so that when someone steals rum from you, and it's possible, though they might get one that's not worth as much. Do you want those bonus cards? Do you want the pirates? The pirates is a cool concept because they can give you great benefits, collect some money, steal from other people, and you can do all that, but then they go away during after the battle's there. And so, do I want to try to get points? Because if you collect a lot of pirates' power and the person next to you does too, are you wasting it? Especially if you lose, you are. And I like that. The artwork, of course, it's yellow. So the artwork is amazing. And it, like I said, it plays very smoothly. The only problem I found is that you do not reshuffle the deck back in. And so at the end of the game, if you run out of cards, you add coins to the spots. And if you play a 4-player game and players tend to leave big piles of cards, which can happen in this game, then at the maybe the last couple turns, they're sometimes they just kind of anticlimactic because there's not much left. I would recommend if playing with 4 players to kind of do an accelerated start to start 1 turn ahead, so there's 1 less turn in a 4-player game. I think that would just make it would run smoother that way. As it is, again, great production values, easy to play, and it's something that feels new. Yeah, we've seen this stuff in Small World, where when you skip different civilizations in Small World, you drop coins on them, and we saw it in Forensia. When you skip cards, you put tower pieces on them. This is the whole concept of this game. You can skip cards, but then you're adding more cards, and there were possibly coins, and making it better for the person coming after you. That works just in a very neat way, and there's enough variety to make this game feel cool and innovative. Sea of Clouds. Dice Tower Judgment approved!
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at coolstuffinc.com.
Shut the door.
Shut the door.